This edition of the 10% Show is brought to you by Roscoe's. And in part by Outlines, the voice of Chicago's gay and lesbian community.
Hi, I'm Tom Rowan.
And I'm John Ryan.
And this is the 10% Show. On this episode of the 10% Show, we go to the world convergence of Mirth and Girth, held at the Holiday Inn City Center. There we spoke with men from around the world who know that bigger is better.
Did you ever wonder what would happen if two gay men danced together at a straight club? Join us for our exclusive television interview with the two men that did and their lawyer from the ACLU.
Bubbleheads? 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 What is a bubblehead? You'll find out when we speak with their creator, DK.
Hi, I'm John Ryan, and I'm here with Tom Rowan, and we're at the Marigold Arcade at Grace and Broadway. All the activity you see around us are the gay and lesbian bowling teams. Tom, do you want to tell us about our first installment?
Well, Jack, Mirth and Girth is a worldwide organization over 10 years old and made up entirely of large men and their admirers. Recently, they held their worldwide convergence at the Holiday Inn City Center, and of course, the 10% Show was there.
I'm with the second coach here, Lee Gardner. Lee, did you have a good time this week?
Absolutely. I think that this convention has been the most successful in the history of Convergence, and we've been doing this now for the past 7 years or eight. Mm-hmm.
So you were one of the co-founders of Girth and Mirth here in Chicago.
Here in Chicago, yes. I was a co-founder starting in 1980, and we have celebrated our 10th year anniversary. But also, I was also the co-founder of the national organization, which is the affiliated Big Men's Club. And we did that in 1985 in Seattle, Washington.
Now tell me, do you have weekly meetings of Girth and Mirth?
No, we have monthly meetings of Girth and Mirth, and also on every Friday night, we meet at a local bar here in Chicago that is Companies. It is just a place that we greet and meet.
Okay, and where exactly is Companies here in Chicago?
It is on Halsted at Schubert, and unfortunately, I don't know the precise address, but it is Schubert and right opposite the Halsted Street Theater Center.
Okay, so anyone that wants to join can go there.
Oh, absolutely. We'll always have a member there from 8:30 on in the evening on a Friday night.
And the next convergence is going to be in Boston. So do you expect a lot of people from Chicago to go?
Oh, most assuredly. We're going to have a lot, as we have always had a large contingent from Chicago, and we will be in Boston full force.
I met three gentlemen tonight from London. Do you expect more people from across the ocean to come next year?
I don't know if it's going to be more, but I do know that at this year's convergence, we have had the largest attendees from the UK.
Okay, well, thanks for stopping by. We appreciate it very much.
And, thank you very much.
And I'll see you at the later events.
Very good.
And this time I'm with Dick Kemp, co-chair of this year's Girth and Mirth Conversion.
Right.
Right.
Or so, the affiliated Big Men's Clubs, Convergence 90.
Okay. Now, tell me, how many members are here in Chicago?
We have just about 200 members here in Chicago. Those are the members of Girth and Mirth Chicago.
And when was it started?
Girth and Mirth Chicago started 10 years ago, in 1980. We are celebrating our 10th anniversary along with this convergence. We have been in operation for 10 years. We are very definitely doing everything we can to let everybody know we're around. Our membership has grown from about 13 at the very beginning. Lee Gardner was one of the founders of our organization. And it has grown by leaps and bounds. We're now up to 197 members. It will be, I would say, within the next few days, we're going to go over the 200 mark.
Well, very good. So tell me, how many clubs are there in the United States?
Well, as of last night, we welcomed three new clubs into the affiliated Big Men's Clubs. There are now 11 clubs through the United States. We also have an honorary club in England. We have another club that is forming in England. We have another club that is forming in Belgium. And there is also talk from some people in Italy about forming a chapter over there. So we are branching out.
Well, that's great. So now, this is another important question for me. Now, how do I get in touch with all the chasers out there?
The best way to get in touch with chasers is to be where they're going to be.
All right. Well, I'm going to join. I'm joining today then.
Okay, doll.
But thanks a lot.
Thank you.
This is Ron Severian, and he's the president of ABC Club here in Chicago. Tell me, what does ABC mean?
It means Affiliated Big Men's Clubs, which basically our headquarters is in California, and it is a group of all of the Girth and Mirth clubs throughout the United States, of which right now we have 11 affiliate members. And hopefully very shortly we're going to have two clubs from England join us, and we have pending three more clubs in the United States. So hopefully our number is going to grow before the end of the year by another five clubs.
So if someone was interested in joining Girth and Mirth, how do they do it exactly?
Well, we do a lot of advertising. If they get the Advocate, we have an ad in the Advocate. Shortly, in several regional magazines and papers, we do advertising, such as Bear is just one of them. And if they write to the address that is in the magazine, and they will send their inquiry to the club nearest them, and they will be contacted. And they can then join any club that they want to.
And where's your next Convergence going to be at?
1991 will be Boston.
Okay, well, thanks a lot, Ron, and thanks for coming by. I'm here with Paul C. from Seattle. Paul, can you tell me, how long have you been a member of Girth and Mirth?
I've been a member of Northwest Chubbies in Seattle, which is another name for Girth and Mirth, since its forming in 1983.
How many different clubs are there?
There are 11 chubby clubs in the United States.
I'm talking with three gentlemen that came all the way across the big pond to be here. So, and your name is?
Philip.
I'm David.
Tim.
What's the name of the group you belong to?
Chubbies and Friends in London.
Now tell me, this is the question I'm interested in. Are there a lot of chasers over there?
Yes, I think that, well, I think it's evenly split.
Great. Well, I'm buying a ticket tomorrow.
Well, you're very welcome.
Okay.
Very welcome.
Well, come back again.
We will.
Thank you.
We will. Thank you.
Thanks.
Are you really buying a ticket?
Maybe.
Say, we are everywhere.
But you know what? You're watching the 10% show.
And don't you dare turn that channel.
You better not.
I always watch the 10% show, like all women.
The Baja Beach Club was the site of a recent incident involving two gay men who found out that dancing together can lead to a lot more than they had imagined. We spoke with Stephen Kleinedler and Charles Ward about their experience, as well as with their lawyer from the ACLU, John Hamill. Welcome to the show. Could you please tell us what happened?
Last November I was invited by the Baja Beach Club. They have these promotional giveaways where you get to invite 25 or 50 people and you come and have their buffet and you get some free drinks. Mm-hmm. So I invited some friends of mine, including some friends of mine at Queer Nation. And on the Tuesday in question, we went down to Baja Beach Club.
No, could you tell our audience what Queer Nation is for those that might not know?
Queer Nation is a, well, how does it go, the exact quote?
Well, I think we can just paraphrase. Go ahead.
Queer Nation is a action group designed to promote gay, lesbian, and bisexual visibility and identity.
Oh, okay.
Okay, I told my friends about it, and we decided to go that Tuesday and take it from here.
All right. Well, we were all there. Some people took part in the food buffet, drinks, whatever. Stephen and I decided that we were going to dance.
Was this kind of a disco, or is it, what kind of place is the Baja Beach Club?
Pretty much of a yuppie bar. The music is pretty standard, you know, 60s, 70s, and 80s, mm-hmm. oldies. And the crowd is pretty much loop, kind not exactly a meat market,
it's,
but not.
It's after work, an after work type of bar where people go to socialize and do the singles thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I would imagine it has a pretty large suburban clientele, but probably gets on the train after they've hoisted a few down.
Okay.
Who knows?
Mm-hmm.
But I think we weren't doing anything out of the realm of what was appropriate to the song or the locale, other than we were two men
mm-hmm.
doing this, which certainly they were not accustomed to.
Mm-hmm.
But that's irrelevant to our
okay.
right to do it. After about 20 minutes, I would say, 20, 25 minutes, a security person came up to us and told us that we had to stop doing what we were doing. And Stephen and I proceeded to ask him, what was it that we were doing that we had to stop? He said, well, you know what you're doing here on the dance floor. And we said, we have every right to do what we're doing on the dance floor by law. In Chicago, there is a human rights ordinance which prohibits against any sort of discrimination based on a number of classifications, including sexual orientation.
Mm-hmm.
That's just information. We didn't mention that to him, but we did say that we had legal rights. And he said that, well, not here, you're going to have to get off the dance floor. We refused. We continued to dance. We gradually, I'd say within 5 minutes, we had two more security people by us. And then shortly after that, a person representing himself as the owner, who we understand now to have been one of the on-duty managers,
mm-hmm.
Said that we would have to get off the dance floor. We again repeated what we had said to the first security person. He said that because this is private property, that that any city law doesn't apply here. We can do what we want to, which is not the case.
So they were
human rights ordinance applies.
They were trying to intimidate us.
And they were trying to stop you from dancing because you are a same-sex couple.
Right.
Correct.
Okay.
Then after that, he actually said that he was going to call the police.
And we said,
go
ahead.
Fine, because we're doing nothing that's out of the ordinary according to our rights. And
he continued to threaten and intimidate us, using
right.
various threats to try and get us off the
various
floor.
Various tactics. One of the more interesting threats that was made by one of his security people in his presence was, and I'm using their language because this is heinous language in my estimation, the two of you should get off the dance floor because there's a group of niggers, quote-unquote niggers, up front waiting to get you.
Mm-hmm.
That was just one of their threats. It got to the point where I would say approximately, let's say somewhere between 6 and 8 security people surrounded us and started moving us toward the door. And the only way that we could have resisted that would have been to be violent, which we didn't do.
Mm-hmm.
But when we got about halfway to the front door, which would have placed us at the main bar of the establishment, which if your audience members haven't been there, is very large, we started chanting, we're here, we're queer, get used to it. By the way, the audience, other than the patrons, other than whispering to each other and observing all of this, for the most part, had no reaction up until the security people started harassing us, especially after they escorted us to the door.
By that point, they were cheering
and yelling. Yeah, they were cheering and acting like animals. In my estimation,
mm-hmm.
It was the establishment which incited this, because
mm-hmm.
had they not reacted in this way, there would have never been a scene.
Mm-hmm. Well, after this incident, you contacted the ACLU.
and or did they contact you?
No. Actually, the first thing that we did is that we filed with the Human Rights Commission.
Mm-hmm.
And they proceeded with their investigation. We had received press in both the Windy City Times and in Nightlines, in Outlines.
Mm-hmm.
And there also had been, it was a full-page story detailing what had happened. There had been a subsequent editorial the next week. And John and his boss at the ACLU, his title I don't know, had been keeping up on the story and called us.
Well, that brings me to the next question. John, if you could tell us, what is your role in this?
Well, we're talking about, you know, with Stephen and Charles, about representing them in the proceeding before the commission.
Mm-hmm.
The commission is now investigating the complaint. And
what commission is this?
The Chicago Human Rights Commission.
Okay.
Or the Chicago Commission
on
Human Rights.
And that's part of the government of the city of Chicago.
Right.
Okay.
That's right. And, you know, they go through now sort of an informal investigation procedure, and then they have to find whether there's substantial evidence of a violation
mm-hmm.
of the city's human rights ordinance, and I'm sure they're going to find that. At that point, it becomes a little more legalistic.
Mm-hmm.
The parties can try to settle the dispute, or if it's not settled, then you have to go forward to a hearing, an evidentiary hearing.
What is the ACLU's interest in this?
Well, the ACLU's interest in general in all kinds of cases is preventing violations of people's civil rights and civil liberties, whether on whatever basis, if it's irrational discrimination based on race, sex, sexual orientation, whatever. This case in particular, I mean, we have a commitment to protecting the rights of gays and lesbians, and we're developing more cases in that area. But this case in particular is one of the first cases under the Human Rights Ordinance's new procedures for processing complaints, and the first one that I think is going to go through the whole procedure in terms of sexual orientation discrimination. And this is an important case. I mean, whether gays and lesbians are going to be able to have their right enforced to enjoy the clubs and restaurants and bars throughout the city.
Now, have you received any other, in your experience, have there been any other incidents such as this, to your knowledge?
Well, there have been other incidents like this. I mean, the complaints we get at the ACLU are usually the tip of the iceberg. I mean, we know that these things are happening, but we don't always get complaints.
Does this seem like something that, in your opinion, what would you think that the outcome of this might be?
Well, hopefully at least there's going to be an order that the Baja Beach Club has to cease discriminating against gay or lesbian couples. The other sorts of things that can be ordered would be, you know, requiring them to put up notices at each door that they don't discriminate on the basis of sexual orientation or other things, requiring them to advertise in the gay and lesbian press so that people feel welcome to go there. You know, the ordinance provides for damages to people whose rights have been denied. So there's a variety of things that can be ordered. The important thing is to stop the discrimination from occurring in the future, and if to some extent they can try to correct the discrimination that they've already been guilty of, like by advertising to reach gays and lesbians to tell them they're welcome to be there, things like that.
Do you feel that many other non-gay establishments will be watching this case with interest?
I think so. I certainly hope so. It's, you know, an important case, one of the first of its kind, and, you know, hopefully a lot of those establishments would let gay couples attend as well as straight couples, but there are probably a lot that don't as well, so I hope that they listen to this case.
Well, thank you so much for being on the show. We're very interested in how this turns out, as well as our audience, I'm sure. And we'll be keeping people updated on how this does come out. Thanks again.
Thank you.
Thank you.
As of April 23, 1991, an agreement between the Baja Beach Club and Messrs. Klein, Edler, and Ward is soon to be settled out of court to everyone's satisfaction.
I'm proud to live in this great free country, and I'm proud of our commitment to free speech, and I'm proud of our country's commitment to protecting the rights of its citizens to work and live free from bigotry and violence. That's why I was amazed to discover that many people die each year in anti-gay attacks, and thousands more are left scarred emotionally and physically. Bigotry has no place in this great nation, and violence has no place in this world, but it happens. Prejudice hurts, kills. Please don't be a part of it.
Lee Kay is a very popular artist with the local gay community. He has immortalized many locally and nationally known celebrities by making them into bubbleheads. These cult artworks have become famous themselves. John Ryan recently spoke with Lee at his Northside studio.
Hi, I'm John Ryan, and I have the pleasure of speaking with Lee Kay, creator of Bubbleheads. Lee, I've seen Bubbleheads around for a couple years now. When did you get started?
Oh, about three and a half years ago, when I was living in an apartment next door.
Where did you get the idea from?
I'm not sure. I think we were just partying one night, and somebody decided to put one of my drawings in the window. We had a window that overlooked Roscoe's patio, and the things I was doing there were really crude. Mm-hmm. But it was fun to get some reaction from the crowd. You know, people would wave and stuff. And
who was the first one?
I think the first one was Tammy Faye, because she was in the news then, Tammy Faye Baker.
Wow, so that was about 3 years ago?
Yeah, 3 years, maybe a little bit more. It was in the summertime, so. Mm-hmm.
What? How did you get the idea?
I just have always been fascinated with people's faces and portraits my whole life, and I've always drawn off and on. But when I had the, I guess when I saw the window, I thought, well, here's an opportunity to see what the feedback is like. Mm-hmm. So,
what was what gives you an idea to pick a certain person?
The more I do, I think that I look for people that are really kind of positive and upbeat and unique in their personalities, and also very strong and willing to stand true to what they believe is right.
So like Tammy Faye.
Tammy Faye, boy, she's in there, whether mascara.
Rain or shine.
That's right.
Oh, I see. Now, the ones that you've done, what has been your most popular out of all of them?
Sometimes the most offbeat ones are more popular than the ones that you'd think are more common. Like when I did Celia Cruz, the Cuban singer, I got a lot of reaction, which was unexpected from that one. And also a lot of the local people that I do who you don't really think are anybody. For example, Bobby Gina from 7-Eleven got a very strong positive reaction from everybody that knew him.
What's the most fun part about doing them?
There's so much like I can't pinpoint it, but I guess doing the cafe window was really great. Mm-hmm. Because
that's the one at Roscoe's?
Right downstairs, which is below the apartment here. Mm-hmm. It's fun to put things in there and get the reaction from people on the street and hear things, you know, through the grapevine. And there's a suggestion box that I have down there. People put ideas in. So it's a whole process from start to finish. The whole thing is just a real kick.
Are they very expensive to create? Are these even for sale?
Yeah, they're for sale. I don't sell a whole lot right now, but maybe in the future I will.
What's the price range like?
They're generally, I generally ask about $250 for the ones that I've done, and commission mm-hmm. pieces are a little bit higher. Mm-hmm. But that can vary.
Have you gotten many commissions?
I'm not as many as the regular ones. I'm actually quite selective about what I'll do because
oh, really?
Some people don't understand exactly what I'm doing, and they think that I can just do like one of their mother or something, and it's I'm really doing more of a kind of a tongue-in-cheek thing. I don't want them to, you know, be offended or anything. Mm-hmm. So
now when you do one of your bubbleheads, would you rather do a celebrity or a local person? Do you have any preferences?
I do Hollywood big names and also local people. Generally, the local people are celebrities in their own right, but they're not, you know, they just haven't been recorded before. So mm-hmm. The more I do, as the years go by, I really enjoy doing the local people more because I can use my own photographs and have more control mm-hmm. over the product that way.
Do you see your bubbleheads evolving into any new direction, or do you have new ideas for them? I can see like a progression where you're doing more with a 3D kind of.
Yeah,
instead of just a flat, you have a lot of things that are.
They get more 3D
accessories.
All the time.
Yeah. A lot of them are accessorized and things like that.
I love the 3D part and the fabric and the jewelry and everything and glasses mm-hmm. and hats and whatever. So maybe they will end up in that direction. It's hard to. I never know for sure. I just kind of go with what the flow is and what I feel like doing and uh-huh. something happens and.
Just like our show.
Yeah.
Well, thanks a lot for being with us. We really
Thank
appreciate
you,
it, and the best of luck in the future.
Oh, I appreciate the interest. Thank you.
Well, as usual, we had a very diversified program, don't you think, Jack?
As always.
What was your favorite part?
Well, my favorite part of the show, I think, would have to be the Mirth and Girth episode, because it's very interesting to learn about a minority within a side of another minority. It kind of reminds you of the cool diversity within the gay and lesbian community.
Well put, Jack. Thanks for watching the 10% Show, and
don't stop!
This episode of The 10% Show has been brought to you in part by Outlines Magazine, the voice of Chicago's gay and lesbian community. And also brought to you in part by Roscoe's, located at the corner of Roscoe and Halsted in the heart of the gay community.